Thank you, madam. Professor Gisela has provided us very good background about what it constitutes the robustness at a local finance level. I'm going to speak on this topic, which organizers have given, that what are the Indian experiences in improving the fiscal health of local bodies. Also, I will speak, because this setting is there, about the general issues of the Indian local finance. So thanks to the organizers, these are the some of the names of the cities which prop up. There were age-old revenue improvement stories of Patna, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, Pune. This started around 1994 after our 74th Constitution Amendment. In fact, I can divide this 25 years in three phases. First phase, 1994, post this 74th Constitution Amendment to 2004 or 2002, when for the first time a central scheme came for the urban reform, URIF, Urban Reform Incentive Fund. Then came 2005, JNURM, that is Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Mission. And then in 2014 onwards, we have Smart City Mission. So that is the third phase, which is last 4 years. In recent time, there are these examples, Bombay doing, then Bangalore, Vishakhapatnam, Ujjain, Raipur, Nashik, Mumbai doing the capital value property tax, Surat only user charge, and Bhuneshwar dangling with the advertisement tax, which got subsumed in GST regime. But the most important and silver lining to my mind in last 3-4 years is the, and particularly last 2 years, is the Telangana case study, where state government initiated a property mapping of 72 ULBs. I will be coming to that later on. The first, and then this slide enumerates the issues which are there with the improving the fiscal health in local bodies in India. Madam, you talked of the three legs. We have cut short two legs of the our municipal bodies. We only have now property tax and to some extent user charge. We never had a local income tax, and we had a local expenditure tax, which we have killed. So we are standing on one leg and then still balancing. Okay, coming back to, if you take my word, then 1994 to 2003-04 was a renaissance period for municipal finance. Because during that period, there was a USAID 5D project, and we all, luckily I am such a fortunate person, I have myself implemented the reforms. I was part of that renaissance period as a young officer in municipal corporation. Then came out at the time of, exactly at the time of 2002 from my service, and for 15 years was urban finance specialist working India and abroad, developing the reforms, fiscal reforms, hand-holding. And since 2014 onwards, I am finding myself redundant. So last year I changed myself and went for the poverty alleviation and livelihood aspect. Why? Because if you look, whatever experiences, if I have to talk, there is no database. Those who have actually lived, they can tell the stories. And entire web literature is replete with all the reforms which happened before 2005. So there is a lack of data, documentation. In fact, fiscal reforms has taken completely backseat 2006 onward, and more importantly 2014 onward. In India, nobody is talking of fiscal reforms. We are talking of smart city innovations and other whatnot. But the basic ground of sustaining all these edifice of local finance, we have in Indian all languages a proverb that you can have all types of roles or the mask, but you can't have a mask of a financially well-being. That's a proverb across all our Indian languages. You can play a role of anything, but not that you are a rich person when you don't have any single rupee in your pocket. So what are the issues? Let me run through. Lack of documentation, failure to report. Even those who are doing something, they are not reporting. And as I said, in entire policy paradigm, fiscal reforms, there are some silver linings, but it has taken a backside of it. There are very few experiences. So you can't find an impact at a national level or state level. It may be at a city level, some cases it has happened. There is a lack of consistency, sustainability, and then there is a lack of ecosystem, including incentive system, to sustain any such reform initiative. So what we see, the cities which have done local fiscal reforms have decimated it. And then last is the loss of mass replicability. Because we are, yes, each city has a different problem, but then we are not replicating. I tried because there is no data, but let me assess from a secondary data. What is the impact of local fiscal reforms in the last 25 years? Are there any? If we take a latest macro data which was available, which was made available for 14 Central Finance Commission, put together 12th and 13th Central Finance Commission, take my word, 1996 to 2002, actually municipal finance share, which is less than 1% of the GDP, had increased 0.61 to 63. And therefore I say that's a renaissance period, because at that time, we all were talking of fiscal reforms and the governance reforms and devolution of functions and resources to the local bodies. Functions got to some extent devolved to the cities, but since 2005 onward with JNURM, it is only funds which are getting devolved without any autonomy. The funds have become project funding. The city which is capable of putting the projects and appropriating that money is a city which can develop itself. A city which is a backbencher, laggard, little bit slow on project, putting the project, is relegating in a bag. Let's look at the figure. What has actually happened 2012? It has come down from 49% to 37%. The share of the municipal own sources into the system. Municipal tax revenue to GDP ratio has come down. It means municipal tax reforms are not happening. The way India's growth story is there, municipal sector is definitely lagging. Non-tax revenue also not keeping pace. And this is a 2012 data. If you will take 2017-18 data, which will be available now when 15th Central Finance Commission, this will come. Take my word, it will be 65% central share or state share and 35% or less. I'm talking of an average. There are municipal bodies which are 90% or 95% dependent on municipal bodies. So municipal finance or municipal finance sector is shrinking in India. The reason is abolition of the expenditure tax. We had a golden opportunity. When the GST came in, there could have been a piggyback tax on that. And that would have made all local finance tenants. Because then it would have provided a differential at a city level with 0.1% taxation, 1 to 2% on that. And then each city could have experimented with its taxation. But we have missed that opportunity. I look at the credit rating. Again, there is no data. Once in a while, we had done credit rating of 63 cities in June, in mid-2008. And very recently, that data has not been made public. But we ranked or did the credit rating of 463 cities, which are part of the Amrut, which includes the smart city also. And you can see the picture. At that time, out of 63, 20 cities were A, that is investment grade, high investment grade. Then 42 cities, that is 66%, were in the B category, and only one city out of that 63 was. Now the volume is more, 463. But the worrying fact is that the A grade municipalities getting A credit rating, A to AAA, has shrunk down to 7%. Out of 463, only 34 cities are in an A category. And then 127 cities are in B category. So it's indirectly indicate, and which I had said 10 years back, that JNURM fund are going to erode bottom line of our cities. And that is going to accentuate with this smart city mission and Amrut funding, particularly smart city mission. How that happened? Because we provided, all these missions are providing capital funding. So infrastructure get created. There were very soft budgetary constraints. Even today they persist and they have become more soft. Because I said fiscal reforms has been taken out of the any contention. Now you have free lunch and free funds. Earlier in JNURM, there was at least a condition that you have to do this. As cities fail to do the income generation, their bottom line has eroded with the increased O&M cost, because in India there is no devolution for O&M. There is a devolution in the O&M end, but that is by default, because a municipal body's deficit is ultimately made by the state government. Let's move ahead. Recently, annual survey of Janagra, they also corroborate that. He will be speaking. 54 cities do not generate enough revenue to meet their salary cost. They studied 26 cities last year. 39% of the average percentage of own revenue to the total expenditure. I was saying 35%, but this is going to be that. 39, there is a big sample. When we'll take larger sample, there will be smaller municipalities with 90% dependence. So national average will go down less than 35%. But there is a total absence about the new success stories. At least they are not reported, nobody is documenting, nobody is analyzing, because it doesn't have a market. At that time, all these diasporas were used to discuss local reform. I'm very happy that you have kept this topic in this seminar. It does not mean that the reforms are not happening. They are happening. And very recently, Hadko Award has been given to the Telangana state for initiating a statewide property tax reforms. And this is the Telangana story. In short, Madam Sri Devi is here. She would be able to dwell later on in her speech. But they carried out in all 72 ULBs a centralized high-tech property mapping of 12.5 lakh properties successfully. 18,000 new properties came in, then geospatial data and tax data of these properties has been placed online. There was another TNU, another funded project in which they took 34 ULBs where 28% of the property tax increase happened, almost 40 crore rupees. Let's hope this initiative reaches the logical and sustain itself in the future. Because earlier same thing in 2006-07 Gujarat did. We did area-based property tax reforms of all ULBs, 159 ULBs in Gujarat. I come from the Gujarat. So, but then, alas, after that for 12 years, neither rates have been changed, nor those area-based benchmarks have been revised. So again, it is at a standstill. It was done at that time. Before going to this, I will talk about why this is happening. The main crux is that soft budgetary funding. We are not front-loading fiscal reforms. There are no pre-qualification for you to get those devolution of the funds. There are political and other legal or policy level, we can say, but not fiscal. So we haven't front-loaded our fiscal reforms. I don't mean to stop not getting ULB's devolution fund, but they must qualify, and not everybody. Look at the smart city mission, 1,000 crore. Out of 100 cities, I have done the number crunching of all the cities. 80 cities were not having their own share of 25% with them. Who is funding? State has come forward and provided them that 25%. Now, 1,000 rupees for Bombay didn't matter, or for Calcutta. Even for Bangalore, Pune, Hyderabad, 1,000 crore is peanut, because it comes annually 200 crore. But for Dharmashala and then other very smaller cities, which are 35 in number, they are tiny tots. If we take the coins of that money, no, they will die under the weight of those currency. Such a small local body of a 50,000 population, Dharmashala, getting 1,000 crore and putting up 2,500 crore smart city plan, which is equivalent to Pune. Pune has placed 2,500 crore smart city plan with annual 4,500 crore rupees revenue and 1,500 crore rupees operative surplus. Such a municipal body puts up a 2,500 crore. I had a privilege of preparing smart city plan of 10, 11 cities. Out of that, 6 were of Maharashtra, well-to-do cities. The first point I put the foot down is that there cannot be an astronomical smart city plan. Nagpur, Kalyan, Dombivli, Thane. You look, we looked at the financial sustainability. I don't know, 2,500 crore with 50,000 population, 2,500 crore even if invested, no chance for next 50 years that city would be able to stand on its feet. Because it's O&M, its annual budget is only 12 crore out of that 9 crore comes as a grant. And that city gets 2,500 crore if it actually gets, even 1,000 crore is something under the weight of which that city is going to crumble, crush. Now this kind, and this is, I just gave one example. I said this is true with the 35 cities which are small, which are less than 1 lakh population or 2 lakh population. Out of 100, 35 cities are smaller. And then there were, for whom this smart city program would have been important or good, is the medium cities, 5 lakhs to 20 lakhs. So the designing of that scheme, correct? And then let me give you two figures. Whom this entire, now all 100 cities together have submitted 2,05,000 crore rupees smart city plans. Out of that, 1 lakh crore would come from the central state and their own sources. So 1,05,000 crore has no base. It's just shown convergence and PPP and all that. Even if we take that 1 lakh crore, it is going to benefit only 4% of the population of those cities. The area-based population, ABD, and ABD component has constituted 76% of this 2,05,000 crore rupees. And total area of the city, which is selected for smart city area-based development, is 8%. So even if this scheme meets 100% success, we will be developing 8% area with the 5% population at such an enormous cost, for which there is no funding to the municipal bodies. It will further erode their bottom line, unless until they do the income generation or fiscal reforms. So what we need to do? We need to front load fiscal health reforms. And they need not be same. The taste for a nursery boy would be different, and then the secondary and the higher secondary and the college and master degree. Similarly, those norms should be different, which they should meet to qualify for the devolution. Also, devolution should not be more than what they can absorb. We haven't taken into account the capital absorption capacity of the... Why fiscal reforms have died? Because cities got more money than what they can imagine, what they can absorb. There was no need left to raise the money. And there was no condition. So that is the real crux which is dying, the municipal fiscal reforms. Strong incentive structure to motivate ULBs to undertake fiscal reform improvement. Today we don't incentivize local body. We incentivize them for any other thing. Also, we don't fund the fiscal reforms. Entire JNURM, the flawed structure was that we made fiscal reforms as a condition for getting the infrastructure devolution, funding for them. And that really created a problem. Doing away with the soft budgetary constraint approach with the devolving fund, and then creating an appropriate ecosystem which would include creation of a centralized IT platform, web portal, and institutional structure for documenting, reporting, analysis, and sharing of the fiscal health improvement success stories of the ULBs. Secondly, creation of the independent financial performance ranking system run by the GO. We got the livability index now, new. It's good. We got the Swachhata Sarvekshan. But where is the fiscal ranking? Where is the fiscal? That system, for 10 years I am talking. 10 years back I worked for the UN Habitat to create a financial indicator system for world. But here it hasn't come in. Creation of an annual credit rating of the ULBs, putting that data in a public domain. All these 463 credit rating reports are not in public domain. And they should be done every year, like a sovereign rating. Then we'll have an independent rating system. Beside that, a GOI-run fiscal ranking system. And finally, regular statutory and performance audit of ULBs by designated agencies and publication of audit report, which we talked in under the public disclosure law in JNURM. No audit report is placed, means there may be exception, but audit reports are not placed in a public domain. I think if we follow this, someday we will have our ULBs with the enough fiscal reforms and money to sustain themselves. Otherwise, future is bleak. Thanks.